Scott Peterson wrote a piece called Don't Go There. He had a trip to Ireland and Holland and other places east of here, or west, depending on which direction you started out this morning. He called a little earlier and said some things about it, but I don't remember if he said anything pointed. Let me just look at this, make sure I can get this done by midnight. Yeah, no problem. Don't Go There is the title of this. Scott Peterson wrote. The TV show host Paul Joseph Watson knows how to rivet an audience. He's young, handsome, articulate, and does it with a British accent. His recorded shows can be seen displaying the CNN logo prominently, so you can just feel it. Mr. Watson is the real McCoy, a genuine newsman. In July of 2017, I had just touched down in Amsterdam to find his latest broadcast on my laptop. It was aptly titled, Why Tourism is Collapsing in Europe. As a top-notch investigative reporter for the Anderson Valley Advertiser, I'd be there to see it firsthand. According to Mr. Watson's detective work, European holiday destinations were being shunned by travelers concerned about safety. The specific threat was Islamic terrorists looking for infidels to blow up, like Judy, her father, and me. Paul's 87, so if we ran into trouble, I didn't have to outrun the assailants. All I had to do was outrun Paul. Mr. Watson would have been shocked at what we saw. The place was absolutely jammed with unclean Westerners. Machine gun-toting cops were nowhere in sight, nor were any policemen, for that matter. Our first room at Hotel Residence Le Coin overlooked picturesque Rembrandt Square and the canal where U2's Bono keeps a houseboat. After hopping on a 20-foot barge for a tour of the downtown area, we noticed a suspicious pack of Farsi-speaking individuals smoking marijuana and drinking gigantic gin and tonics that obviously just arrived from a Taliban training camp and were steeling themselves for a suicide attack. So we kept our distance. Our next stop was a city swarming with Middle Eastern troublemakers, Eindhoven. The main employer there is technology giant Philips, so naturally Al-Qaeda would have a presence. My assignment was to infiltrate an event hosted by a couple whose family had immigrated from an absolute hotbed of Muslim extremism, Indonesia. If you're looking for violence, everyone knows where to find it, at a wedding. Dutch authorities were all over it. Just to keep things under control, they tailed the groom to the event with a pair of uniformed motorcycle cops. These weren't ordinary gendarmes either. They were from the Dutch Military Intelligence and Security Service, obviously on duty to prevent the beheading of any hapless Western journalists. The ceremony took place next to Lake Puttenkaron, which didn't show any signs of recent refugee activity, but you never know. Dark-skinned, turban-wearing, AK-47-toting guests weren't obvious, but they never are. And the 50-some-odd partygoers were obviously petrified, but never showed it. So we all ate, drank, and danced like there was no tomorrow, because you just never know. Guest Sophie Kiela and her husband Erwin, have a taxidermy business in Nijmegen called TheMuseumWinkel.com. Museumwinkel. Among their amazing portfolio of work is an African elephant standing on its head, the completely articulated skeleton of a beautiful 18-year-old woman done at the request of the decedent's mother, a lamp made from an amputated leg commissioned by a one-legged donor, and a genuine fetus ordered by its loving uterus. But more intriguing of all is an authentic shrunken head they've affectionately named Henk. Henk came from the Jivaro natives of Ecuador circa 1860. It wasn't exactly commissioned, but Sophie and Erwin got it nonetheless. And for the super low price of 49,000 euros, you can have it too. Erwin estimates there are only about 1,500 shrunken heads in existence today. None of them as handsome as Henk. So be sure to keep that in mind for your next little bat mitzvah surprise. Sophie and Erwin's business isn't shrinking. They've got 13 employees and more work than they can handle, undoubtedly reassembling decapitated Western reporters for clients like Mullah Omar when the need arises. Ulrich Mangold works for Bosch in Germany. He's the vice president of their automotive aftermarket division, working in the finance department there. I'm about a head taller than him before a few beers, but that distance seemed to vanish in no time. When I asked what he thought about the obvious superiority of Americans, he said something strange. "I see your country as a conundrum," Uli told me. "It's both a developed country and a developing country," adding that we've got great culture and innovation on one hand, but could use a little improvement in the self-governing area. The interesting thing is how he delivered that message with a British accent, just like Paul Joseph Watson does, which seemed to add a little something to whatever he said. Huh. Uli went on to elaborate on what that meant. Quote, "When I get a one-sided chain email from an employee about a dispute with another employee, and I get a number of them, I forward it to the other employee and tell them to bring their dispute to me together," he continued, "and I always tell them to recommend two courses of action." How does that work? According to Uli, it always kills the dispute right then and there. That didn't sound very American to me. Hans Elling is about 6'3" and a dead ringer for Mr. Clean. His line of work is building maintenance. Every wedding reception has somebody like Hans, a man who just tears up the dance floor. His family is from Germany, too. "There are no absolutes here," Hans told me, "but too many immigrants." Aha! Now we were getting somewhere. Elling assured me of my safety here, explaining if he ever threw a punch that missed, police would be here inside of 10 minutes to take him away. Yet that didn't apply to immigrants. "They live by special rules," Hans said. "And they beat our women." It's hard to dispute an account like that, especially with somebody who could have dropped me like a bad habit, but here's the thing. The average Middle Eastern male, sans suicide vest, stands about 5'9" high and is downright scrawny. Your run-of-the-mill Dutch female is easily 2 inches taller and fit as a fiddle, so I ran that by Judy's sister, Susan Kalkwis-Beam, who's married to a man of Indonesian descent. Did she know anything about violence between Middle Eastern immigrants and Western women? Her response surprised me. Susan worked at a foreign aid facility in Seattle right after the first Gulf War. She saw firsthand what happened to Middle Eastern men who tangled with Western women. All of them got their asses handed to them, which reinforces the first part of what Hans told me about there being no absolutes. Did Hans have any firsthand knowledge of that violence? No. So that's game, set, and match to Susan. At the stroke of 2 a.m., the bar closed. The next day, we spent some time with the bride's grandfather, who came to Holland from Indonesia in 1950. His choice then wasn't any different from refugee options today. Either stay put and die, or immigrate and live. The exodus of Allied forces there after World War II left a power vacuum, just like the one we see in the Middle East today. Holland's doing its level best to pick up the slack, giving food and shelter to refugees until they can get on their feet. But that's seen by many Dutch citizens as unfair. The bride and groom, Susan and Nick, are both employed by the Dutch Secret Service, so I asked Nick what he thought of Russia. "I don't like Russia very much," he told me. "They're not taking any refugees." That echoed what Hans had reported. He spoke of liking Russians, but not Putin. Still, he admired him. "He is a very smart man," Hans said. When the alcohol finally wore off, it was time to get the hell out of jihadi-infested Holland. But first, we had a one-week stopover in one more place famed for European terrorism, Dublin, Ireland, where a 20-minute ride on the DART train took us to the picturesque seaside village of Howth. On a hill overlooking the harbor is a stone building that houses ye old hurdy-gurdy museum of vintage radio, a not-to-be-missed walk through time with our host Michael Walsh, who reassured us that terrorism certainly wasn't lacking in Ireland over the last century. While England fought Germany during World War I, Ireland fought England with German rifles. During the 1916 uprising, British forces actually shelled Dublin. By World War II, the Irish still hadn't gotten the message and actually stayed neutral during that conflict. Violence isn't a recent thing on the Emerald Isle either. A visit to the National Museum of Ireland proves that, where the bodies of well-preserved but eviscerated and/or decapitated bog people bear gruesome witness on what happened to unwelcome visitors, not to mention the very apex of armed Nordic intruders and what happened to uncooperative hosts. Vikings, like Shia militia, were armed to the teeth. At the time of their visits, the Irish were no match for them. An ancient skull shows that, with the right frontal lobe cleaved off clean as a whistle. There was an interesting selection of recently discovered hoards on display, too, revealing tons of ancient treasure dug up over the past century or so, something that terrorists obviously haven't discovered yet. After just one day of seeing things that tended to support Watson's grim narrative, it was time for a beer. Throngs of tourists hadn't heard about all the violence in Dublin, so the streets were packed with them. Ditto for the world-famous Irish pubs that forced us underground, literally, into a place beneath Brogan's Bar on Dame Street called Underdog, where Chris Murray offers no less than 18 brews on tap. When I asked him for a hoppy IPA, his face lit up. How about a marching powder? That ale is made by Black's Kinsale Craft Brewery in County Cork. The alcohol is 6.5%, putting it squarely off limits for observant Muslims, and the hops are extracted cryogenically. Not wishing to be rude, we ordered a second and a third pint. Probably more, but I lost count. With the prospect of multiple car bombs going off nearby, we somehow choked them down. Then afterward, we staggered up the cobblestones to Chris's suggestion for dinner. Bullen Castle is a 4-star steakhouse on Pembroke Street. Our first attempt at getting in fizzled because they were booked solid. We got in the next night, though, only because Chris's partner, Barry, made the reservation for us. He tipped me off that Chris's girlfriend worked there. And wouldn't you know it, Dominica was our waitress. Once again, the place was packed with Western infidels. We started with the FX Buckley cured salmon, served up with blini, chive creme fraiche, and mustard honey dressing for €9.50. That's 9.5 euros. €9.50. Then moved on to a 22-ounce ribeye steak for €44 that stuffed all three of us. After admiring the delicious smoky salt that topped our entree, Dominica popped the whole shaker into our doggy bag, likely because she knew I was a foodie from the world-famous AVA. In between, we had two meals at Murray's Bar and Grill on O'Connell Street. I ordered the lamb shank there for $15.95, twice. The place was full, even more so once the live music began, clapping our way through tunes like Irish Rover and Whiskey in the Jar with taboo beverages. We almost forgot about all the Islamic terrorists plotting against us outside, but hearing no gunfire or explosions, we decided to walk back to the hotel. The distance from Murray's to the Parkway Guesthouse on Gardiner Street is only about a mile, but it's on the north side of the River Liffey, i.e. the rougher part of town. Thus, I expected to see scads of foreign extremists there. However, nary a hijab or turban could be seen, so I asked our host Seamus Hefferman what the deal was. According to Seamus, the only violence in Ireland these days is a turf war between Irish gangs. It's not over religious or political ideology either, but drugs. In a scene reminiscent of The Godfather, six hitmen armed with AK-47s stormed the way in of a lightweight boxing match and killed the enforcer of one faction, triggering payback against the other. The rivalry has left countless Dubliners dead, and much to the dismay of my editor, none of them were tourists. If anything, it appears the Irish hooligans actually exported terrorism to foreign lands, thereby shooting a gigantic hole in Mr. Watson's theory. Our brief stay at the Parkway Guesthouse was interrupted by one night because Seamus was booked solid. That gave us a chance to reconnoiter the south side to see if any jihadis were lurking there. Thanks to Airbnb, we found a room, yet once again, no armed refugees. Huh. The only danger we felt on the entire trip wasn't from dark-skinned foreigners, but from light-skinned tourists wanting the same thing we did, food and lodging. Go figure. On the trip back, an 800-page book titled The Better Angels of Our Nature gave me one explanation, that violence is actually on the decline. The reviews were impressive enough. Bill Gates called it one of the most important books I've read, that's in quotes, not just this year but ever. Author Steven Pinker attributes much of that to human evolution, and get this, democracy. He also lays out some interesting facts about our understanding of violence, including a statistic showing that of 14 major world powers, the last to abandon judicial torture was the Vatican. Yeah. Also, of the top 20 worst violent episodes in human history, number 7 took place in the USA. That's the annihilation of the American Indians, and at the very top 27 of all the planet's wars, where do you think the per capita death toll was highest? In the Kato region, of Mendocino County. Pinker's bona fides seemed pretty watertight to me, so I went to my favorite travel guide, Rick Steves, to see what he thought about traveling in Europe today. Mr. Steves made that case with statistics. According to the Washington Post, your odds of being killed by a terrorist overseas are 1 in 20 million. Your odds of being struck by lightning are 1 in 10 million. While your chances of being killed by gunfire in the United States are 1 in 32,250. Translation, for every citizen killed by a terrorist outside the USA, 620 are killed by terrorists here. That prompted a second look at Mr. Watson's claim about tourism collapsing in Europe. Johnny Jett's a fellow who travels 150,000 miles a year to 20 or so different countries. He's also appeared on every major news show in the country, except for Mr. Watson's. According to an article he wrote in the Huffington Post this past June, the truth is that Europe is a place no more dangerous than where you already live. My next stop was Mr. Watson's television show to see if I'd gotten anything wrong. A quick review showed me what I needed to know. The thing that looked like a CNN logo on Mr. Watson's video wasn't a CNN logo at all. And the reference material that Mr. Watson cited for that episode was written by, get this, Mr. Watson himself. And as it turns out, Paul Joseph Watson has a reputation for being full of shit. That's reported in an article by Salon titled InfoWars, Paul Joseph Watson Can't Get Anything Right. That's the title. Among Watson's claims is that there's no such thing as moderate Islam. Islam is a violent, intolerant religion, which in its current form has no place in liberal Western democracies. In other words, Paul Joseph Watson doesn't get out much. The Salon piece goes on to cite 22 articles where Watson has gotten things wrong. He seems to do something right, attracting two fans whose names you might recognize, Donald Trump and Donald Trump Jr. Boy, I get another beer. That was an article titled, Don't Go There.